Okay, we are live. Okay, 3, 2, 1. Hello, everyone. Welcome to episode 115. And we initially called it pre-TEDx, but I think we want to discuss a lot about Dr. Craig Wright, or fake doctor. If Craig is even his real name. So we wanted to start off with that. But first, I just want to mention that this episode is brought to you by the Humble Bundle and No Starch Press. Humble Bundle, for $15, you get like 10 awesome, and I mean really awesome books by No Starch Press about hacking and exploitation and Bitcoin and all these other great things. So we really recommend it. This is not a paid ad. They do not pay us. I paid my $18 or $15 if you want to be really cheap, and I got it. And I really recommend them and all those books. And let's bring in Tom. Tom's going to tell us about the doctor.
Yes, yes. And I do have to, you know, put some props behind No Starch Press, because they're at just about every big name hacking convention out there. They sell good books at a good price. Everything from like simple explaining stuff to in-depth tutorials on, you know, writing buffer overflows or diving into an executable with Ada Pro, like really cool in-depth stuff. So if you need some books, go check it out. I mean, it's less than $20 and you can get a whole bunch of good stuff. But yes, Dr. Craig Wright. But before we discuss that, I would like to make an official announcement on the show. You see, I have this piece of paper here, which shows absolutely perfect proof. And I'm sorry for those podcast listeners that can't see this amazing proof. But this, I have signed this cryptographically, and this proves that I am indeed the one and only Satoshi.
Satoshi Nakamoto.
I created Bitcoin and the internet and global warming. And this is signature. It's a signature. It's cryptographic proof. It's true. I didn't just scribble on this paper just now. It's from when I created Bitcoin. I drew that. I was inspired.
If you want to laugh, and you got to listen to the whole 2 hours, Steve Gibson, I don't know, 10, 15 minutes goes, I am the Satoshi Nakamoto. For all you youngins who don't get that joke. And then Leo Laporte had to jump in and say, Steve, the real Slim Shady is the real Slim Shady. And he goes, wow, a joke that spanned both generations. I did laugh at that. So,
yeah. So we've had yet again. Craig Wright, I'm not even going to call him doctor. I don't know if he's a doctor. There is so much about this guy to not like, and frankly, I kind of hate that we're giving him airtime, but it's been the new hotness in the security cryptography, crypto coin community for about a week now. A while ago, he came out and he said, hey, I'm Satoshi. You know, made Bitcoin and all this. There's some leaked blog posts that shouldn't have gotten out and some weird emails that Wired picked up. And, oh no, I'm found out now. But it kind of all went by the wayside when someone said, well, you know, show me the signatures. You have the private key for the Genesis block. You can sign a message with the original private key that we know Satoshi went ahead and, you know, he mined the first block to make the first Bitcoins. And he put out a blog post recently with a bunch of just trying to look smart crypto stuff, that when you actually looked at it, when you actually dug into it, it was full of typos. It wasn't actually the signature that the people wanted. Even Gavin Andreessen, one of the big, proponents of Bitcoin, one of the big guys that, you know, has worked on it and has been a part of the Bitcoin Foundation for a while, you know, came back and said, okay, look, I totally thought he was going to show indisputable proof. He pulled a fast one on me. I don't know where this stuff came from, the stuff he put on the blog, but none of this makes sense. And there is no way that this is proof of anything ever. So, yeah, Craig Wright is not the creator of Bitcoin. Satoshi is still an alias for a secret person or group of people.
Well, the fact is that he conned Wired and Gizmodo independently. I mean, Gizmodo is not that hard to con, but Wired is. I mean, you would think that Wired would absolutely red team this, and they believed him.
Which it's so for anyone that doesn't know Bitcoin, right? For anyone that doesn't know cryptography, doesn't know public key cryptography, doesn't know how these things work, will look at his proof, at his blog post, and it's, to the layman, it looks really impressive. He is a really good salesman. This guy didn't get where he is by being some idiot, right? He's not just some random used car salesman trying to sell your grandmother a lemon. He's a professional con man, from what it looks like. Now, you know, that's, I have no proof of this, but from everything the person has put out, everything this guy has said and posted, it's just, it's lie after lie after embellishment, and just about nothing has any actual substantial real proof behind it. It's really easy for the layman to get picked up in this, to get swept up by it, and to actually believe this guy. And I don't think we can fault... I am going to fault Gizmodo because they're generally lazy. Wired should have done fact-checking. So yeah, we can fault the journalists in this one. But, you know, for the average person that picks up the story and reads it and goes, oh, wow, that's cool. They found the Bitcoin guy. You know, I can't really fault them. But the journalists should have done their due diligence.
The question then becomes, so it was Dan Kaminsky who says, this is what we want. And he put some excellent articles saying exactly what we're looking for. And Gavin Andreessen saying, yes, I believe him. I was trying to follow it. He conned me saying, oh, you got to do this and you got to do that and you got to do this. And I'm thinking, why is this blog post so long? Like, honestly, like, what kind of proof do they have to prove? I'm thinking, oh, maybe he's belt and suspendering. He's like, oh, this is part one. This is part two. This is part three. And I'm thinking, and Dan Kaminsky said this best, show us the Bitcoin. Show us the first Bitcoin. That's all we want.
Yeah, yeah. So because he has mined the Genesis block, he has got some of those coins from the Genesis block in a wallet somewhere, right? In a Bitcoin wallet. All he can do is someone says, hey, send me 5 cents, send me a dollar, give me a whole dollar from the Genesis block, and I will trust beyond a shadow of a mathematical doubt that you are Satoshi. And he can't do that. Then they said, okay, look, I'm going to hand you a random piece of text, and you will sign it using the private key that mined the Genesis block. You'll sign it against your private key, and I can take your public key from the Genesis block that we have, because the Bitcoin blockchain is public. We know what Satoshi's public key is, and we can verify that that signature is accurate, proving that Craig Wright would be Satoshi. But he didn't do that either. Instead, he chose some weird, you know, further along the blockchain quote from Sartre, and it looked like he just signed a hash of something. It's just weird. The way he put this convoluted thing together, it's a typical con man thing. The proof that we need, that the Bitcoin community needs to prove out that someone is Satoshi, is really easy. This is public key cryptography. It's not rocket science. It's not anything truly, truly difficult. It's really easy to see, is this person who they say they are, or are they not? We have built an entire system of currency, of cryptocurrency, around this entire idea, around the entire premise, that it would be easy to establish trust cryptographically. We don't have to take him at his word. We're not supposed to.
Well, let me ask, I have two questions. The first question, so every Bitcoin, every single sub-fraction of a Bitcoin has the blockchain. Don't these blockchains, take away the first ones, but like somewhere in the middle, something mined, I don't know, a year ago, aren't these blockchains getting really long? Can you like sanitize these blockchains and like, I don't know, you know how money gets recycled? Can we recycle these?
Yes and no. So the fractions of the Bitcoin aren't actually in the blockchain. The only thing the blockchain is a ledger. It says, hey, you know, this person has this much, this amount of Bitcoin, and he sent this fraction to this person. And now that is codified in the blockchain. Now we can look at the blockchain and say definitively that this address has this amount of money because it flowed from here to here. And it's a linked set of transactions cryptographically that makes that all happen.
But you have to store that whole thing? Like, don't these things get really big?
It depends on your client. So there are some clients that work off of a blockchain that don't need a full copy of the blockchain to work. But the full Bitcoin QT client, as it's known, or the Bitcoin Core client, will require an entire copy of the blockchain, which is, last time I looked at it, it was a bit under 100 gigs. So it's not exactly a tiny, tiny thing. But what that also allows you to do is it allows you to go back through literally the entire history of Bitcoin from the very first transaction to the most recent, and you become part of the transaction holder. You become part of the worldwide trust network that is holding the public ledger.
So if Craig or Doctor, whatever you want to call him, or the real Satoshi says, I have, here is the first Bitcoin. I'm going to donate the first Bitcoin to the EFF. Here it is. Is that good enough? That's it? We're good?
If it flows from that wallet, because we know where the Genesis block, we know where those coins ended up, right? We know exactly what public key controls the coins from the Genesis block. If that person were to send money to the EFF or somewhere, they could even optionally sign a message saying, you know, Craig Wright is totally Satoshi, LOL. And that would be the proof. That would be the burden of proof. That proves that the person that mined the Genesis block has control of the private key, which means a couple different things. It either means, yeah, they're the real deal, they have control of the private key, or somebody hacked Satoshi, grabbed his machine, stole his private keys, and that would be impressive, right? Because now they've got who knows how many Bitcoins, because, of course, Satoshi was one of the earliest miners, right? He created the thing, so he's got to have a decent amount of money stored up.
And talk about money, like printing money. He literally printed $100 million to do this. If he sends the second blockchain, can't you say that's what they were saying? If he sends like the second or third one or the sixth or seventh, he's close enough that he probably knows who he is if it's not him.
Yeah, I don't think it would be Satoshi at that point, but it would probably be someone close to him.
It's or like someone groupie.
Yeah, someone who either was friends or buddies or colleagues or even was in the same group that decided to make Bitcoin. Because, you know, we don't know that Satoshi is a single person, right? It could be a group of people. So it could be in the same work group or class or, you know, I mean, mix something up. It's somehow connected, right?
My weird question is, what happens if Satoshi died? Or what happens if he, like, will, like, I said Men in Black did, where he got the little, like, the memory wipe. He doesn't know where the blockchain is, but he, like, put clues or somebody. It's like one of those mysteries we're going to see on the History Channel in, like, 30 years.
Now that would be an epic level of tragedy if the person who created Bitcoin lost their private keys to the Genesis block. That would be tragic.
Like, oh, or it's in a safe deposit box and then he died and then something like that.
It's possible. I mean, you know, we only have the unknowns here. We only have speculation. The thing that we do know, though, is that Craig Wright has not sufficiently passed the burden of proof to be considered Satoshi Nakamoto.
Do we want the real Satoshi to, like, step forward? Like, do we really care?
I go back and forth on this because now we know fairly well who the author of True Crypt was, thanks to, and I will point this out because it is some fantastic journalism, and we will put this in the show notes.
There are no show notes.
Yeah, don't worry about it. But if you join our WhatsApp in 30 chat, which we have over here, we will totally get you an invite to that, and we will be posting links in there all the time.
There are the cryptographic show notes.
It's end-to-end encrypted show notes. It's everything you need and everything you want protected because no one knows how to cryptographically share public links better than us. But it's called The Mastermind. You can find it at mastermind.atavist.com, ATAVIST.com. And it actually goes through a computer programmer turned like crime boss turned drug lord, like really weird, straight out of a movie kind of stuff. And it proves for the most part that this is the person who originally wrote True Crypt and the story behind it. It's a really fascinating tale. And it honestly, it's kind of hard hard to believe. But, you know, now we know who wrote TrueCrypt. We know kind of some of the gory details behind it, that it was part of another project, and then a company hired him to do some work, and he basically stole code from that company to make TrueCrypt happen, which got forked and branded and put into another project, and then it grew up, and now it's VeraCrypt. But it's interesting to know that, but you also lose some of the romance around it. You lose some of the mystery. You lose some of the great finer points of, you know, just thinking and wondering about Satoshi, and he must be sitting on a beach somewhere, sipping Long Island iced teas and just wasting away in the sunset, because why wouldn't you, right? You just created something awesome. You should, you know, kick back for a little while.
I just want to know that he's not like a 12-year-old prodigy. I want him to be like a 75-year-old retiree who just sat there and decided, I just want to make a cryptocurrency. Like, that's what I'm thinking. Who is the – it's R and the RSA. Who is the old guy who looks
– Rivest. Ron Rivest.
That's what I'm thinking. No. Diffie Whitman. He's the guy who looks with the beard and the sorcerer-looking thing.
Yes.
That's what I'm thinking. That's kind of what I want.
What I want is – I want – at DEF CON this year, or DerbyCon would be better, I want Taylor Swift, like the real Taylor Swift, to come out, live tweet from the Info Taylor Swift account, "Sup guys, I'm at DerbyCon," take a picture of the crowd and send it off, and then send the first Bitcoin to the EFF, verified from the Genesis block, and then drop the mic and walk off stage. That's what I want to happen.
That would be awesome. The Rise of the Machines, DEF CON 24. So, okay, next story. We're having too much fun with this, and we took enough time. The WhatsApp has been shut down again for 72 hours, which really is only 24 hours, in Brazil, based on some weird thing that really got overturned. Basically, some judge said that if you don't provide us X, you will be shut down for 72 hours, which will cause 100 million people in Brazil. That's a lot. But basically 91% of all Brazilians use WhatsApp, and now they no longer can communicate. That's a big deal.
Yeah, this is absolutely huge. And this is not the first time this has happened. If I remember correctly, this is the second time that it's happened.
By the same person. It's the exact same person.
So Brazil says, dude, WhatsApp, come on, give us the plain text data. And WhatsApp goes, bro, I don't have it. It's end-to-end encrypted and stuff, so sorry. And Brazil goes, banned. And they blocked it at the ISP level. Originally, I thought it was a DNS block. It's not. They actually forced their local ISPs to block WhatsApp communication from getting outside of the country. So Brazilians, tech people, security people all said, all right, you know, here, use Orbot, use Tor, use these VPN connections, and then you can get outside the country and use the internet, you know, the way the founders intended. I don't get this. And I understand why they do it, but if the judicial powers that be understood anything about technology at all, what they're asking for simply doesn't exist. If you want plain text conversations of an end-to-end encrypted device or end-to-end encrypted call, you need the device. This is the only thing that can read those conversations. Nothing else. And until they get that device for the one or two people that they really want, they can't do anything. WhatsApp can hand them, they can roll their database servers into the courthouse and say, here you go, here's everything. Except for the metadata of who's connecting to who, they literally have nothing. They can't give anything more than that because they just store the noise.
I would turn over the noise. Say, here it is. I mean, you want the noise? Here's the noise.
Yeah. Well, apparently the judge was asking for, you know, plain text conversation details, and WhatsApp was, sorry, doesn't exist.
So apparently once the lawyers got involved, higher, whatever district, higher than the district court judge that banned it, reversed it again, less than 24 hours later. But this is where the Brazilian, I mean, Brazil's in a state of chaos right now, but they should uprise and say, hey, look, you're not, we're using WhatsApp to bypass the carrier fees. That's what it is. 50 cents a message in and out is a tremendous amount of money, where data is obviously much cheaper. So I think they should start saying, look, if you want us to start using SMS or you want something else, don't make WhatsApp the only game in town. And apparently nobody cares except now when they need the information. I don't know.
Apparently, according to a few Brazilians that were asked about this, they said that this is a fairly common happening in Brazilian courts, where the judicial officials they have a word for it, which basically means there's not a direct translation to English. It basically means, you know, I'll fix it by the power of the pen, which means they can just write a law or write a subpoena or write a warrant or, you know, write something and make all the problems magically go away. Like, that is the solution. It doesn't matter if it takes moving the moon or stopping the rotation of the earth. The power of the pen will prevail. And obviously, it didn't in this case, and it hasn't in several others. So,
and by the way, like you said, Tor, VPN, all this stuff works.
Yeah.
So once again, they block the person who doesn't care about encryption from using it, and the people who do care about it obviously got around it. Though, if they're, I think they were looking for drug dealers. I bet you those drug dealers know what a VPN is.
Yeah, and I bet they're already using it. And you know, every time something like this happened, because I remember in college when the Pirate Bay's domain names kept getting shut down, you know, every 4 days, it took not even hours for the new domain names to circulate around the entire campus. You know, it would just get passed from person to person. Hey, I can't get such and such movie or such and such game. Do you know where to find it? Oh, cool. The Pirate Bay is back up on this other domain. Not that I have ever participated in copyright infringement ever in my life.
Linux distributions.
Yes, I only put Linux distributions on the Pirate Bay. Ubuntu was very hard to get through HTTP downloads. Remember.
That is true. That is actually a true statement. I will verify that. Anyway, yes. Anyway, moving on really fast, really, really, really fast. Unanimously, the House passed a law for the first time in forever. They passed a law, and it's the House Advances Email Privacy Act.
This is fantastic.
It's not awesome, but it is. It's not the everything we wanted, but it's a good deal of it. Which will require the government to get a probable cause warrant from a judge. Okay.
Yeah. So where this basically the impetus for this bill comes from the fact that email laws and email protection laws were written in a day when email was temporarily stored in a server and you went out and fetched it. So you have an email and it hits the mail server, right? It's just sitting there on Google or AOL's mail server. And at the time, what you would do is you would use something called POP. And what POP did is it would go to the mail server, your computer would grab all your messages and pull them back, deleting them from the remote server and copying them to your machine. Now, what the law was based on is that exact protocol. They said, okay, if an email stays on a server for more than X days, it's like 140-ish days, if I remember correctly, then it is considered abandoned. Well, what happened is people got a lot of computers. They have laptops, they have desktops, they have phones, and other protocols that instead of pulling the mail and deleting it from the remote server, because that's awful when you have multiple devices, just decided to interact with the mail sitting on the server. And that's where we have IMAP, we have Exchange, we have, you know, if you use some of the more esoteric things like Novell Stack. But IMAP and Exchange are the two big ones that interact with the mail directly on the server. What this means, what the previous law did, is it said that after 145 days, any mail is considered abandoned and the government can just reach in and grab it without anything, without even thinking about it. They can just say, hey, can we have this email? And they would hand it over. Now, my Gmail account has got a decade's worth of email in it. I don't consider that a bandit at all. But what this bill does is it basically provides a lot more protections for email, not as much as the post office system, the physical post office system provides here in the States, but a pretty decent deal of protection.
The problem is that we're still trying to figure out the digital and the physical. And like you said, the post office is a lot harder, and digital, we're saying, well, we should just ask, and why can't we receive? So law enforcement just says, hey, Google, turn it over. What's the big deal? And Google says, why? And then we have a power struggle. Well, we just want right. it. And the court says either, okay, and we're hoping, unfortunately, we found out the wrong way, that they've granted every single request recently. But we're hoping that a judge says, wait a second, why do you need this? Oh, you're going after him for stealing $57 worth of fried chicken? Really? Well, I think that's important. Okay, here you go, and forces Google to turn it over. Now, Google does make it a little harder, but at least now there's a judge has to be put there, and hopefully these judges are learning some of the new technologies, and hopefully we'll see a little more pushback.
Yeah, education is really the key here to anything as far as getting, you know, members of the government involved and able to make better decisions about technology. I don't believe all of them are willfully evil. I just do believe that most of them are willfully ignorant. And, you know, it's not their job to be tech experts, right? It's their job to be policy experts and schmoozers and, you know, people that shake hands and kiss babies, because that's literally their job. They do that every day. They have to be good at it. But I think, you know, a little bit of education, a little bit of, hey, this is how things work, and this law doesn't really fit the way we're doing things today or have been for the past decade. So can we change this? Apparently, most everyone in the House understands that email should probably be better protected than it was. So they passed the law, and unanimously. I mean, that is huge. I think that's really the bigger story here, is not that the law got passed, is that not a single member of the House of Representatives disagreed.
There was no bacon in that law. That was the problem. There is no there's no rider that says, oh, we're also going to pass CISPA at the same time.
It was a simple, clean bill. Look what happens when you have a simple, clean bill that no one has issues with. This is so weird to me. I felt like I was in a dream when I read that.
It's like a one-page bill. We should require law enforcement to get a search warrant. Wow, that makes sense. We should do that because everyone has email.
And you did mention it before, but here's a nice 30-second story. Apparently, a law enforcement officer was using a stingray to find someone who stole $50 worth of fried chicken.
Which is in the WhatsApp group show notes, which you can find by messaging the In30 account, and I will get it to you.
Yes.
It does involve you exchanging phone numbers with me or with Tom, but that's how WhatsApp works. We promise we won't spam you because we don't really care. So anyway, with the last 2 minutes, I just want to tell everyone I'm speaking at TEDx East Brunswick High School. I guess if you call up TEDx, TED, and you say, hey, I want to do a TEDx thing, they say, okay, you are limited to 100 people, but you can have it. Here are some guidelines, and they have a whole litany list of rules. But my topic is, and I'm talking to mainly high school students, is why you should have something to hide. And so I'm working on my speech now, and I'm just going through teenage-based ideas of, are you aware that these things happen? And I'm trying to hit on two things. One, 20 years ago, we didn't have selfies. Selfies weren't a thing 20 years ago. Blogging and Twitter.
Better days. Better days.
I always remembered me having a camera and pointing it at myself, and people thought I was weird. Now that's like the new it thing. And my question, and now this is a little more of an adult podcast, and I'm not that old, but 20 years ago, when we wanted to take a photo, I'll just leave it as a photo to hold and to cherish or to give to somebody, what did we do? And I'm struggling to figure out that answer, mainly because I kept on getting told, you didn't do that. And now all of a sudden, with digital cameras and everything being digitized and in the cloud, all these things are just put up there and no one thinks twice. But it's weird. And I keep on saying, well, you hid stuff under your bed, you hid stuff in your corner. The door to your room was your privacy. And now what is it? Oh, it's your phone. But oh, there's nothing on my phone. And that's where I'm trying to figure out exactly where my avenue wants to go with of what I want to say. And people who've seen the speech ahead of time really seem to like it. What I want to do is after my speech, I want Tom and I are going to go in depth into it a little more than the 10 minutes that I have as sort of, okay, you heard the overlying themes. Do you want to go more in depth? And here we're going to be, and hopefully that will be published for next week's episode.
So. Yeah. So it's going to be really cool. You know, the talk definitely aimed at your high school crowd, but the podcast is going to be aimed at everyone because we all have something to hide. And if you don't, you really should. I mean, think about it. Think about literally everything you do. If everything you do is completely public all the time, you're probably pretty creepy. So have some secrets. It's good for society.
Yeah, you want to be known for something, and I don't know. Have a secret or two. Anyway, we are over, so we're going to end it now. Again, Nick, join our WhatsApp group and humble bundle it. You're going to have a good time. Anyway, we will see everyone next week.
See everyone.
Bye. Pause.